Hi, and welcome everybody to another episode of Hashtag Ask Jochen. This is the online series, live stream series, where we gather for an hour a week, typically an hour a week. We've missed a couple weeks now, but Jochen actually sits down with us and answers some of our saddle fitting questions. So I just want to welcome everyone and take a couple moments just to make sure that we are in fact live on YouTube and Facebook. And if you guys could just comment where you're from, or if you are tuning in and watching, just shoot me a comment in one of the chat boxes if you're on Facebook or if you're on YouTube, and we will just notify Jochen to come in once we know that we're live. So I'm just double checking this. So we are live on YouTube, and yes, it appears we're live on Facebook as well. So perfect. So for those of you who aren't familiar with this series, again, it's called Ask Jochen. And on this front page, we actually have some information about Jochen if you're not familiar with him. But for now, we're going to move onwards with our introduction theme because we do have a lot of questions for tonight. So we're going to move swiftly onwards to this introduction sequence. Sometimes it's a little finicky. There we go.
Well, hello, Mary Claire. Long time.
Welcome. Long time. It's been a while. It's great to be back, eh?
Yeah, no kidding. I was like saying to myself, wow, I'm feeling I'm missing something. And that's our talk, you and my talk. It really jazzes me up, and it's good to be back.
For sure. Yeah, it's a great time every week, and we appreciate your time. I'm sure everyone who... all of our regulars who tune in and watch have probably missed having this time to learn and spend this time with you, Jochen. So thanks for dedicating this hour to us. We appreciate it.
You know, the live stream is all about, like you said, question and answers, right? And people sending them all the questions, and they're looking for answers. But the main truth here, I'm looking for answers all the time too. And I was brought up by parents who always said, good enough is never good enough. And the person knows the how, but always follow the person knows the why. So for me, when it comes to saddle fitting or problems people have with their horses, and I can isolate and says, it's definitely in the equipment, then I just need to know why. I need to know why. And I don't take the answer like, because I say so, or because I have a gold medal, or because I have lots of money. I really need to know why. And I think that's why people follow us, Mary Claire, is because we not just say because it is so, because we give a lot of examples and we can back it up with all these research we have done ourselves or together with experts from all around the world, like these two, three incredible professors and spokespeople like Gerd Heuschmann. And doesn't matter if it's people who understand the bone structure, how the bones are deformed from ill-fitting saddles, or people who written the facial expression. These are all experts from literally all the way around the world, even in the racing industry. People who have followed us, they know these slides quite well. And I decided today, Mary Claire, that I make this introduction a little bit faster because I wanted to give more time to people who have these questions. You just told me we got so many more in just at the 11th hour. So I don't want to speak a lot about me. I was just want to make sure people have a better understanding. This is not a typical behavior of a horse because it's Monday, or this horse hates women or hates men. There's a reason when the equipment comes, and we have to be really, really aware. Many horses suffer in silence, and that has to stop. And that's why I do what I do and listen to experts such as medical doctors, gynecologists, who says, hey, the interface between two beings, between a man or a woman and an animal, the horse, it's the saddle. And this interface has to take two beings, two skeletons in consideration. So anyway, Mary Claire, how do you like my introduction so far?
That was great. Well, I think that was the most, that was the quickest introduction I think I've ever seen you do. And
it's
that
enough was about really me. Great. It's all about the horse and the people who are taking the time and listen to us.
Right. And like I did say to you earlier, we did get like a flood in of more questions, and they're really, really interesting questions, and I'm sure that you're going to love tackling them. So let's hop right in. The first question I got was from Facebook, and this lady, her name is Jocelyn, and she's asking, is it possible or realistic to hope for long-lasting and well-made vegan saddles? I am recently vegan and I'm trying to lower the amount of products that I have with leather. Obviously, the performance and quality of my saddle is very important to me, but can this be done without leather? Thanks.
Okay, so yes, it can be done without leather. And Jocelyn, I understand what you're going through. And my children also decided to become vegan because of the way the animals are treated. Some people become vegan because of health issues. And some people just want to reduce the amount of leather use, just like you, Jocelyn. Totally understand. So I want to, it's typical Jochen fashion, to answer this question in a sense of I understand why it can go without leather. While it's not the skin, it's the hair. So while is it the best? Is it because it's an animal product of an animal product? Mary Claire, I just see a sign here that the internet is unstable. Can you still hear me?
You cut out a little bit just now. Yeah, I was still seeing your video, but your audio cut out just slightly, but you came back.
Okay.
So if you could start over maybe just that sentence.
Okay, so a lot of pads made out of a material like cotton and synthetic or gel or rubber, like these pieces here. But the best part for the horse, what has been researched in Vienna by the University of Vienna, the professor's name was Christian Pam, was sheepskin and deerskin. So if my daughter or you says, I don't want animal products on that animal, why do that work so well? So it's a natural product, and this product here is there to protect with their skin, the horse's skin. So we have to think about horseback riding. It's not meant by nature that a human sits on the horse. So over all these years, people use products, is a gel, synthetic, sheepskin or leather. We come to learn that certain products will protect the horse better, such as this sheepskin. Now let's go to leather, to the actual saddle. And when I'm talking about saddles, bareback pads or what they call treeless saddles, you can see here is made out of synthetic or like a neoprene here, like these pads, okay? The entire saddle can be made out of that as well. And the question is why if it's so much better for the manufacturer to work with material what is not so expensive, why do the majority of the people love leather versus synthetic? Because today, material like this material is this fake leather, we call it. Many shoes gets made out of that, especially in the theater world, when they have to make costumes for different plays. You really have to burn that material to see the difference if it's leather or fake leather. The material is so good, the imitation, that you barely can tell the difference. So the advantage is it's super durable, there's the answer. So you could have something out of non-leather, very durable. And the disadvantage, that particular material is super expensive and it doesn't mold and take the form to the rider's seat and to the rider's legs and to the horse's back as leather does. So while we have very inexpensive neoprene or another material, what is sort of a blend between neoprene and velvet, and we have this fake leather, the majority of the consumer prefers the leather because of how it molds and feels doing riding. For people like my own children who will have less and less leather product, for durability, this definitely is a product when can be used. It's just a little bit more expensive because leather will dispose in ground. So when the leather saddle one day is gone and we don't want to use it anymore, or you throw it away, or you bury it, it will dissolve the leather. This material will never, never dissolve. And it costs a lot of money to produce. That's why it's more expensive to make and less used in the market because of the cost. Unless you go to neoprene, like with the Wintec saddles, then that's affordable. Leather, again, molds. But if it's an ethical thing, there are these options. Did I expand that a little bit, Mary Claire, or was I too vague there?
Yeah, I think you did a great job of, yeah, I think that's essentially what she's looking for, like that the options are out there and that they exist and the advantages or disadvantages of them. So that's perfect. Thanks, Jochen.
Yeah, I think what I would like to add is where animals get treated very, very bad for food consumption, meat consumption, right? They, these are not animals anymore. These are just tools or products. And we cannot use that hide from those animals because they're standing in their own poop and manure and their skin is actually burned. The only skin we can use in the saddle manufacturing is cows that live on large, large fields. Most desired skin with the tannery, this is a company what takes the byproduct of the dead animal, the skin, from cows who live on large, large herds where no manure can burn or no fences can destroy their hide. So these animals, these hides are way easier to use. Why? Because they don't have any flaws or burns. And the hides from the mass production, what people do with these poor, if it's goats or pigs or cows, they're totally useless for the saddle industry because they're laying in the poop and the leather is completely burned. So that's maybe something to consider as well.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha. Okay. Thanks, Jochen.
You're welcome.
Perfect answer. I think we'll move onwards through our list, blazing through our list so far. Only 15 minutes in. So this question is from Emma on Instagram. And soon after she asked this question, someone else asked what I think is kind of like the opposite of the question. So I figured you could probably tackle both.
Sure.
One after the other. So the first question was, can one saddle fit multiple horses? And then soon after, somebody else asked, can one saddle fit multiple riders?
Okay. Mm-hmm. Good. So let's have a quick look at this picture. So we have horses in nature. They love to live in the ground, in the group. And in nature, they have their head down 17 hours a day and they walk 20 miles. When we take them in captivity, we take away what they do in nature. We don't feed them 17 hours a day. We put them in a small confined area. And those animals get fed 2, 3, sometimes 4 times a day. And some have a little bit, or we call them running stables, and some have a paddock or they live in the field. But we kind of take these wild animals, domesticate them, and take away what nature's make them do for certain reasons. What has that to do with the questions? Very easy. When a horse gets ridden, which is not nature, in an environment, in a 20 by 40 ring or jumps over things or does a little bit pleasure riding, going hacking, again, not nature, the body will conform. If I'm a pleasure rider or like this young horse gets trained to a very muscular Grand Prix dressage horse, the body will go through some changes. And even if you say I have one saddle and I can fit it to the multiple changes my horse goes through, the horse will change. So most professional or people who have lots of horses and can't afford lots of saddles, I always refer that to a large family who have more than 10 kids, let's say 12, 13 kids, and they live in an area where the kids may have to share the shoes. While not all of the kids can wear all the shoes, but certain type of kids can wear the same pair of shoes. Where I'm going with this is, in the pair of shoes, you can wear shoes which are just a little bit too small or too large. You kind of make your foot squish in there. But if it's lots too small, you can't squish your foot in there because your foot will deform and it hurts. And if it's way too large, you slide out of the shoe when you wear way too large shoes. The same goes with saddles. So if I can generalize one thing, if you want multiple saddles to fit, make sure you have plenty of space for the spinal, horse's spinal column, okay? This is way, way, way too small. Look at the width of the hand of the person. You need to have this stuffed area, we call that the panels, a minimum of a hand width. If you don't, first you can see deformation, or you see with thermography the heat. Yes, you can do plastic, you can do surgery and fix the problem. But if you want multiple horses, go where you have your hand width all the way through the bottom of the saddle. And then you have an extra shimmable pad. That's a saddle pad. You can add shims to it, which you secure to the saddle. And when you have smaller horses, you use that pad to take away or give the extra padding you require. If you have very round, roly-poly horses, you go ahead and do a thin pad. Now that's the number one. The number one, you have to have a saddle what fits the spine. The second thing to fit multiple horses is, this is where I come in with a shoe size, where you have 12 kids. You can't have the youngest with the oldest pair, the youngest kid with the oldest kid sharing the same shoe, but you can group the kids in certain shoes. In the horses, you group saddles, the horses where the mane goes to the left, to the right, I'm sorry, okay? That's your right-handed horse. You see the left shoulder much bigger developed. So you have one saddle with a very wide channel that can fit to all your horses who are right-handed. Then there's horses who are left-handed, which means the mane goes to the left. And then there's a horse where from pole to withers, left and right, the mane splits even. Compare that to a human. We are right-handed or left-handed, or we are ambidextric, which means we can ride with the right hand and left hand. Okay. And in saddle fitting, you can get away with fitting multiple horses in one saddle if you categorize them in your right-handed and left-handed horse. Very important. And you save yourself a lot of problems. Sometimes it's just the muscular structure. This horse is very even in the muscular. You're looking at the front, look at this horse, much stronger developed here. And sometimes it's also structural because this upper arm is straight, this upper arm deformed. Think about deformation. If you were one of the kids who grew up in a family with lots of kids, but you were a lot of the same pair of shoes like other kids wore, but you didn't go up to the next size. You wore the shoes where your toes kind of flipped over or crunched underneath. While you're in that growth spurt, you will deform your foot. So that's what can happen with horses, not only in the upper arm, but also in the muscular structure. Muscular, I can fix through training. Structural, like the bones, you cannot fix. So the next thing I like you to point out is the actual length of the saddle. So what you do, let's say you have 10 horses. First you divide the right side main to this side, the left side main to this side. You will see 7 out of 10 have the main core to the right, 2 out of 10 have the main core to the left, and 1 horse from 10 might have the main split exactly even. If you have a horse where the front part of the neck goes to the right and the bottom part goes to the left, that would be still considered a left-handed horse. Whatever is on the withers counts. If they split on top to the right and on the bottom to the left, if that would be my horse, I would call a chiropractor or acupuncture or a horse osteopath. Most likely that horse is out at C4 and C5 in the vertebrae. So that is towards how do I fit a multiple saddles, make sure it has the nice spinal clearance, make sure you put your horses in groups left-handed and right-handed, and wherever the mane ends is most of the time where the shoulder ends, and wherever the last rib is, where the lumbar starts, you got to measure the distance. You can see the ring of lights here. That's the no-no zone. That's the zone you cannot put pressure. Here you see the marks after riding, how the saddle left the mark. If you follow my mouse, you can see both of these saddles were way in the dark zone. So these saddles are too long. So you can measure horses looking from the side. Okay, so here you see again the dark zone, from the dark zone to the end of the mane. So you have your right-handed horses, all the manes going to the right. You will have out of those 7, probably 5 horses who are between 16 and 17 inches in the saddle support area. Flip the saddle over, measure the length. Here's your bottom, what touches the horse. Measure the bottom, what touches that area. And then you can avoid hurting the horse in the back. If you figure out the length, if you figure out the horse is left-handed or right-handed, you figure out the balance. The rest you can do with shin pads. So the answer is yes, it can be a multiple fit. I recommend the number 1, the channel. Number 2, the length. Number 3, your left-handed and right-handed horses. And last not least is the tree width and the tree angle, just like they're done in the past with army saddles. Okay, most army saddles or saddles for multiple horses were always wide in the tree but narrow in the angle. And the best way to show it, let me see if I find that slide here, is from D-ring to D-ring. So from this D-ring all the way across to that D-ring, if you measure it, that's the tree width. And then from the D-ring down to the knee roll, that's a tree angle. So if I'm not going to find this here in the next 10 seconds, I'm going to stop this slideshow and I will grab a saddle, because that's maybe then a better way to show you. And it looks to me like I have to do that, because I, as always, when I look fast, I don't seem to find the right slide I want. The second I stop talking, I will find it. So now I will give up and show you what I mean. So let me get that saddle. So here you see the D-ring there. So from this D-ring to that D-ring right here, see this area? I can't even get a fist in it. That's a narrow tree width. And then the sides, okay? So if I'm looking at, this would measure the horse's angle of the shoulders, that not measures the tree width, because these two corners there, and then there, they stay the same, okay? So same with this tree, this stays the same. It's just that the side arms flares out. So this here will fit a particular horse, will never fit multiple horses. So if you want a saddle that fits lots of horses, this is not it, because this is way, way, way too tight. A saddle that fits a lot of horses has a super wide tree width. That is from D-ring to D-ring. There's a D-ring there. D-ring to D-ring, super wide. And these sides are steep. So you can have a saddle that lays around the horse's withers and away from the shoulder. And just to show you how important it is that the gullet width is also wide, I can put my whole fist in between here. And as a trainer, as a horse owner who has a lot of horses, I rather ride with this because that fits multiple horses. Second question was, can I have a saddle that fills multiple riders? Absolutely. But the first I would do, is I will ask the same question and an analogy or comparison. If I'm a father of 10 children or more, God help me, hopefully not ever. But let's say it's the case, and all these kids need clothes, I would never go with the girls to the boy section or with the boys to the girls section. The boys will buy boy pants, boy underwear, boy clothes, and they can share each other's jeans. And they will not share the jeans from their sisters. And the same with saddles. When you want to have multiple riders, okay, I'm talking about your average rider, 90% are females. Yes, they're very petite, very tiny females and very big, large females. But if you are your typical shape, the majority of the females can share a female saddle. The majority female can share a male saddle, but not without hurting themselves or hurting the horse. And that is proven so many times in different articles and different pressure testing. For you to ride in a saddle for multiple riders, first thing, gender appropriate. Just like the father with his children, where do you want to buy the jeans? In the female section or in the male section? Well, it depends what child you have. If it's a guy, goes to the guy's department. If you're a girl, you want to share a saddle, start with the female seat. Why is that so important? Shoulder, hips, and heels cannot be achieved if you ride as a girl. I don't care if you're an Olympic rider or basic rider. You cannot, even as an Olympic rider, achieve a pliable seat and have a plumb line. If you sit in a steel reinforced wood tree or even treeless saddle, it is physical impossible. And if you force yourself and hopefully never be filmed with a slow motion camera, you will deform your body and cripple your body. I mean, that's all written in medical books and journals. But if you don't want to do it and you want to share saddles, share one what is made for a female pelvis, female saddle. Just to drive this home, the male saddle has a high peak, so his male parts can roll this way down or this way, because there's no male rider who wants to fall on this male parts. No woman wants to have that point in the crotch poke into her, because her female parts are not outside, they're inside, and she can't, like the guys can, put the parts left to right. So for her, she gets killed in the crotch, and the only way to avoid it, heels go up, butt goes back, and that of course is a horrible position to the horse. But like this medical rider, doctor says, also a rider says, if you want to cripple your body, don't share saddles with the wrong gender. If you're in the average rider, the only thing I recommend, make sure that your thigh roll or your knee roll is on Velcro. So that is probably the second most important part, that knee roll never hits your reflex point on the knee or blocks your lower back. It is, I think I read more than 35 books from Professor Eckhard Miners, who wrote about the biomechanics of the rider. He was a professor in Germany at the University of Lüneburg. And he really driven that point home, that if you don't have a pliable seat, a smooth seat, you will do a lot of damage, not only to yourself, like the disc problem or the soft tissue or the joint damage. So long answer, I apologize, but in order to ride in a saddle for multiple riders, Male have more space here, female has less. Pick the right gender appropriate saddle. Otherwise your nerve, the sciatic nerve on the inside thigh, will react first and then the horse.
Please do not apologize for that really great answer. Yeah, that was, we appreciate the length and the extensiveness of your answers. And that was a really great one. So thank you. Kelly was asking, just as you were finishing up the multiple horses question, she was asking to clarify, I think, so it was about the mane falling to the right. Does that mean that the horse is left-handed if the mane falls to the right, that the horse, the shoulder on the left side will be more pronounced?
Yeah, so
yeah. Okay.
Let me explain that a little bit more because it's deceiving.
Okay.
When the horse favors the stronger side, and they will always on flat land when it's not raining, favor to use their strong leg, which is the right leg. And I explain that in a minute why. When the horse grazes, he puts one leg forward. Okay, he's just moving here, mm-hmm. puts that leg forward, but in order to go down, he needs to stay in the stride. So what next time you watch horses grazing, I encourage people to watch them when they're standing, not moving, on what leg most of the time will be forward. It is the left side. So the supporting strong leg is the right side. They're standing on the right side. Then the left side, the left leg is forward. And just like when you do bodybuilding, weightlifting, the muscle grows the most when you stretch it, not when you contract it. Of course, it's a combination of contracting or stretching. But from what I've been told from our personal trainer, he says, in the stretching lies the strength, okay? So, and builds the strength. So the horse's left is further forward. That makes that left leg stronger. The right leg, you're looking from the front, bears all the weight. Mm-hmm. And if the rider sits and falls to the right as well, of course, the upper arm will not hold that weight and starts to deform. So in the veterinarian world, when the mane goes to the right, their supporting leg is the right side, that's their strong mm-hmm. side, and their horse is right-handed. And the left shoulder is more stretched and is more developed. So it's very hard to understand, mm-hmm. but what
it's
really hit it home,
yeah.
But really hit it home for me, Mary Claire, was when a osteopath said to me, you know, in nature, the horse wants to move 20 miles and has the head down and grazes 17 hours. And like on humans, the horse has the appendix on the right side and the digestive tract on the right side. So when they fight in the herd, they guard their right side, the gassy, blowy side, where they digest the food. They fight with the left. We mount from the left. We hold the horse from the left. We lead the horse from the left. And we're vaulting, gymnastic on horses to the left. We race around the left side. Very few race circles to the left. So the left side is the secure side, where the appendix and the digestive system is on the right. So when the horse grazes and digests, the rib cage is to the right. So they place the right foot as the stabilizer and mm-hmm. stretch with the left leg to go forward. Multiple okay. articles are written. One of them is Dr. Carrie Ridgway, the high heel and low heel syndrome. And you see a lot of horses have a low heel on the left and a high heel on the right, mane going to the right. Only when the wind comes from the other direction, the horse will turn the butt around. And only if they're standing on the slope of the hill, they will place the left hand as a stabilizer. So in other words, the valley is to the left. So I'm placing my left leg as my stabilizer and I graze with the right leg forward. So mm-hmm. if you look at movies on TV and you see the show on mountain goats, when they graze on the steep, steep hill, in order for them not to fall down the hill, you will always see the leg to the valley supports the animal from rolling down the hill. Mm-hmm. Same nature with the animal. Okay, so to finish it off, the mane goes to the right, the horse is right-handed.
Awesome. Thanks, Jochen. Yeah, that was really well broken down. And I think definitely answered Kelly's question. Thank you for that. So I'm just going to give Jochen a couple moments to relax for a bit because he's been explaining a lot. And I'm just going to thank everybody for joining us and asking even more questions. And Johnny, I will be taking your question next. So thank you for your patience. I just want to remind everybody that we have, if you haven't heard yet, we're doing a massive saddle giveaway. So by the end of this year, that's December 31st, we'll be announcing the winner of a Schleza saddle giveaway. So to enter that giveaway, all you have to do is click the link that I will be posting in the comment section of the Facebook live that you're viewing right now. And all you have to do for the giveaway is just follow us on our socials and you'll be entered to win. So definitely enter and share it to your friends because the more people you share it to, the more entries you get as well. So definitely check that out at the end of this live stream. And let's move on with Johnny's question. So Johnny was, hoping to ask this question last time we were live. And unfortunately we didn't get to him. So I made sure to want to prioritize his question now. So he is asking, what about men riding in saddles for women? I've got a Schleza fitted for me and my horse. So I think he's asking in the context of female saddles being made for women, he's asking, what about a Schleza for men?
Okay, so as I keep pointing out, there is such a difference between, if I quote Dr. James Worson, there's so much difference between our curvature. We have a longer tailbone than the female. And our hip socket comes out of the side much faster and straighter. And we sit with our back butt closer to the horse than the female. So a female can have organ, like chronic bladder and kidney infection, chronic from a saddle, hip and knee damage, joints and L4, L5 disc. If a guy sits in the female saddle, what he feels because of his long tailbone, straighter lower back and butt cheeks closer. So if he rides in the saddle, he feels always slightly pushed forward a little bit. But he also feels like, because the front of the saddle in this area here, for females, there's a hole. So that is so the female part doesn't get hurt. No guy likes to ride in a saddle where that is flat because when his parts don't go left or don't go right, and we as guys fall on our male parts, that can be quite painful. And in the male saddle, that foam is always in this crotch area where the number two is, always foamed on the male saddle like a point. So when we take these two casts, male and female, and I enlarge in this here, you see there's a big hole from the lady's pubic symphysis and nothing here on the male because we as guys don't have, well, we don't have a birth channel. So for me as a guy to ride in the female saddle, it's not very comfortable and not very easy to balance, but at least, except hurting myself for a moment when I land on my male part, at least it's not long-term damage like a woman riding in a male saddle. If, however, like to ride in a saddle, then I, for me as a guy, I would always prefer the male seat, what has a nice point, narrow in the seat bones, so I can drop my leg down and I feel my horse even constant everywhere around. Okay, so for me as a male rider, I would want to sit in the saddle what's made for my pelvis, in my shape and not sitting on a female saddle. If I have one saddle and I have to share it between my wife and myself, I would always, always fit it to the wife, to the woman. If I'm a trainer, I have a lot of women who ride in my lesson. I can advance my students and my trainer, my ladies faster than me. It's always whose priority is out there first and where can we have less amount of damage. To summarize it up, if I'm a male, I ride in the male saddle if it's just for me, because in the end of the day, that's what I'm trying to achieve without fighting the equipment.
Gotcha. Thanks, Jochen. Yeah, I think he also wanted to add that he does ride well in the saddle and it doesn't hurt him. Mm-hmm. But as you said, compared to women, I guess there's a lot less long-term damage that men can have from riding in a different gender saddle. But that's great to know. Thank you, Jochen.
You're welcome.
And thanks, Johnny, for your question. Let's move onwards to our question from Kelly T on Instagram. So this is from, she has a little bit of a backstory as well. So I started riding only 6 years ago, and at age 42, saddle fit is something that I questioned from day one, because being older, I could feel the issues right away. I regularly do Rolfing, which is an active release therapy, and my hips are always so tight, which actually affects my chest and my shoulders. What exactly is happening in my saddle to cause this?
Okay. So let me think for a second how I'm going to answer this question. I think I have a good starting point. Okay. When I sit on the toilet or I sit on the chair, my lower back is round and my butt is rolled kind of back and my lower back is flat and my butt cheeks are very close, but my knees are in front of me and my feet are in front of me. When I ride, I have to have my balance, which means the ball of the foot in the stirrup has to place my foot under my sternum of my body. If I ride dressage, that seat is also known as a standing seat. That means it looks like the rider is standing, okay? But instead of having the weight in the feet, the weight is in the seat bone. But the leg has to fall out of the hip socket in a very straight manner. And sometimes I can move it, sometimes I can't. Very temperamental, my PowerPoint today. Okay, so the you can see it looks like she's standing, but it's a, here we go. It's a saddle stand and she's sitting on the saddle. So you want to be able to suck in your belly button to the spine. In other words, tilt your pelvis. And you want to stick your belly button forward, make your lower back hollow without falling backwards or forward. So we call that the pelvis tilt. When you sit over or straddle over a horse or a saddle in this case, your leg will pull. You have the stirrup iron here and that stirrup iron gives your leg a little contact, but you do not put that much weight into it as if you put with your seat. Okay, so now what I'm going to do, I'm going to turn this off and I will show you something and trying to simulate something. So let's say this is your left leg, your right leg, these are your knees, and this is your legs. Okay, so just like my finger, your knee can only go this way. My leg, not my finger, can turn this upper leg out this way because of the hip socket. Okay. If I want my toes forward, I want my leg to go this way. So now I want you, everybody who's listening, look at the other hand, pick up the finger what has the sharpest nail and push as hard as you can in that little skin there. Push as hard as you can. And then you will feel that hurt a lot. Okay. So if you have something poking you in the crotch, how long can you hold that pinch? Not a lot. So that would be if a rider sits in the saddle, what is very pointy in the crotch. So what we just talked about in the previous question, when the seat foam has a point. So how does that relate to the question with the hip? sometimes the saddle is too pointy in the crotch, and sometimes, so what you do now is make two fingers like this, put your thumb underneath, keep them, and now try to push as hard as you can and see if you can push your fingers to the skin. You will see you cannot do that, okay? You cannot bring these wide fingers so that this hurts. So when the saddle between your upper inner thigh, right? So if I go backwards here and I tilt the camera, okay? So here's my crotch, this is my thigh. I put my hand right in the upper inner thigh. So from thumb to ring finger, thumb to ring finger would be, let me find a tree. Would be that tree, okay? So you can see it's right there, okay? So if this doesn't fit the rider properly, then we have this issue. And when you try that, you will see it is like somebody tries to rip your fingers apart. And where does your lower leg go? It sticks away from the horse. Now you're trying to bend this in. And if you bring your lower leg to the horse, your knee and your hip will really hurt. Now what I like you to do is just take one finger and hold it inside so you have contact in your upper inner leg. It doesn't cut your crotch, but it's a nice even contact. Your legs can hang relaxed to the side, move back and forth. You got contact through here, but it doesn't bite you or rips your thigh apart. So saddles, come in different areas through here. Now I have a horse that is super wide. A wood tree can never fit properly a rider who has to be sitting in the saddle with a narrow tree and a wide tree width for the horse, because when I widen this, these bars go wide as well. So there's many people who have beautiful Baroque horses or wide-shouldered horses, the saddle gets widened, but then this widens here, right? So certain trees you cannot adjust. Wood trees you cannot adjust. They're not meant to do it. Adapt trees, okay? You can make this as narrow or as wide. You will see nothing changes through here. Adapt trees, you can make the saddle and adapt it to any size horse you ride, without making the rider painful in the upper inner thigh. So in order to understand, let me just go back to my slide. In order to get a saddle to not get hip pain, you have to figure out the right amount of saddle between your upper inner thigh. And the reason the pain shoots all the way up is because on a inner thigh, I think I had the page out earlier, we have this nerve, and that nerve, the sciatic nerve, can travel up sometimes and cause a lot of problem. Here it is. Oops, it's too large. Here we go. There you go. So this nerve runs on the inside. Here you see an average girl, average boy. The neck of the upper thigh, the femur, is longer, and then it goes cone-shaped inside. Then straight down. And, you know, let me just turn this off here. Okay. Mary Claire, you're still there?
Yep, I'm still here. I just got a message.
Still see my screen?
Yep, I still can. Yeah.
Okay, so here you can see on the guy has a shorter neck on the femur, straight knee, straight femur through the knee. So we have way more space here. So if a rider, especially female, who has less space here, but sit on the saddle, what's too wide, that causes tremendous stress on the pain on the knees, like I demonstrated with my hands. The toes and knees point out, and because of the nerves you have here, it can travel up all the way and cause not only damage to the horse, because you will slip from one side to the other in order to sit straight, and then the horse has to compensate for that as well now. So that is from the books, from medical doctors, and from me, for the first time, I understood how important it is that the saddle fits the rider. Mary Claire, can you read the answer again, the question? Because I feel like I haven't answered that question correctly. Maybe I have.
I think you have. I think she was mostly asking what exactly is happening in the saddle to cause tight hips. And I think you've explained the situation at which that could kind of breed that out of her her experience. But as always, it's kind of likely recommended that she see a professional, like a saddle fit technician or somebody who is experienced, saddle ergonomist, who could evaluate her own particular situation and make professional recommendations. And but yeah, you could always provide your insight, which is what you did. So that was great. Thanks, Jochen. I was just getting messages saying that my internet connection was unstable, so I was hoping that you weren't experiencing that, but I think that the connection is fine. It's stable. Okay, so let's move onwards for now. And Johnny said thank you for answering his question as well. And he says, I guess I'll have to see if Jochen could make me a male saddle as a one-off. And I said, that's definitely something that we can do. So we'll move onwards. I think we have time possibly for one more question as we're quickly approaching the end of this session. And just before we wrap it up with one last question, I just want to remind everyone who's watching of that saddle giveaway, because we're quickly running out of time to promote that, because it's coming up really fast. So if you'd like to enter, don't forget to click the link that I will post right after I ask this question, and we will be selecting a winner on December 31st. So you'll definitely want to stay tuned for that and let all your friends know, because you never know who might be winning that beautiful Schlaese saddle. And again, it's a saddle of your choice. So any discipline, it's completely available to you. So let's move onwards and tackle the last question of the evening. And this is one that comes up quite a lot, Jochen, and I think you've heard it before, but it comes up in different ways. So this person asks, what are some tips for better saddle fit for people who can't afford custom saddles or buying a new saddle?
Okay, so I like to promote my book a little bit here, because not only can you buy it on our website, you can also buy it on Amazon. And we got Educational Book Award of the Year last year, exactly a year ago in Kentucky. And I'm very proud to say that in many universities they use this as textbook. I wrote this book with many other professionals, veterinarians, trainers, and just to make it a little bit easier, and definitely will help you with questions like this one. What are the tips for, read it again for me.
Sorry, Jochen, I was muted. I always forget that I mute myself. So what are some tips for better saddle fit for people that can't afford a custom saddle or to buy a new saddle?
Okay, Mary Claire, what are you thinking about the first thing I will answer?
The first, what you'll answer with first? Yeah. The best tip is, I'm not sure, because I know that it's important to.
When you have to buy a used pair of ski equipment, do you buy first the boots or the skis?
Well, I fit to my foot first.
And why?
Because that's it. That will determine what size ski you'll buy based
and
off of
binding
what,
and so forth, yeah. Right? Mm-hmm, so my first tip to your question is fit yourself first. Used, new, custom, off the shelf, or let's say there's four or five saddles somebody wants to give you as a present. The very first is fit yourself and let them know if you're a boy or a girl, and get a boy saddle or a girl saddle. we do, believe it or not, make the odd male saddles. Jamie Irving, one of the probably top riders in Canada, incredible horseman, and rides in our saddles for many, many, many years. And if you're a guy, you want a male saddle. If you're a female, you want a female. Then the next thing, the very, very next thing is wherever you buy it, if it's on internet, Craigslist, from a tack shop, you want to ask them, can I adjust that saddle to my horse? So from D-ring to D-ring, right? The distance there is the tree width. Ask them, can that saddle be adjusted in the tree width? If they say no, don't buy it. No, don't buy it because you don't enjoy it. You just wasted $400, $500, how much you want to spend, right? So if they say yes, ask them how. So they will tell you. Independent, you see the tree in green here, okay? This tip, from the nail to the tip. Think about this tool I showed earlier. Can the tree be adjusted in the angle? You can see the distance from this corner to this corner. That's the tree width. Okay. Can the tree angle be changed? Yes, no. If they say no, don't buy it. Unless you like wasting money and throw it away. The following question for the horse is, what's inside the stuffed area? Is it air? Is it wool? Is it rubber? I always recommend to go with wool because wherever you live, you will have professionals probably around. At least professional can fit wool flock panels. And that's what I recommend you can go by. Now, you can get relatively good used saddles. If you're not saying, oh, I don't have that kind of money. There's so many good used saddles and Schlese saddles, female saddles. We like to call them pre-loved ones. On the market for relatively low money. So if you want something shiny and brand new, then you most likely have to pay the price because they have this one fits all type philosophy. Looks very good, but the saddles cannot be adjusted. If you're on the budget, you're much better off get a good used saddle, what is gender appropriate, what can be adjusted in the tree width and tree angle and the flocking. And they hold their value. And then when you have saved a couple of pennies, you want to upgrade, you get the same money back for what you bought it if you look after it. That is my advice to all of you guys who are looking for some tips to get a good fitting saddle for horse and riders. Mary Claire, I think what you should do, you should maybe list on our website, the
used saddles.
Used saddles list, you know, where you can go and you have the link of the used saddles or the link of the long distance fitting kit. Mm-hmm. Thought I have it here, but I don't.
I think what people might be looking for out of that question is a shortcut to saddle fit, and there really is none. And the thing is, if you have bought a saddle that isn't adjustable, like there really is no shortcut to it, right? And you could be causing damage. And it is probably important that you do either download our fit kit or long distance fit kit and do the measure, take the measurements yourself and look into it for yourself and have a professional look at this information as well and give you their professional opinion. Because at the end of the day, I think I speak for everyone when I say that you'd much prefer to spend money than to see your animal be hurt or hurt yourself in the long term. So I think I would assume that that question almost is looking for a bit of a shortcut to saddle fit, and there really is none. Is that correct, Jochen, for me to say that?
Yes, I mean, but then on the other hand, there's reality too, and people can't just always get their saddle fitted. I kind of feel for them because mm-hmm. they love their horses just as much. In the end, you're absolutely right. There is no shortcut. But if you have a saddle what has the spinal clearance, the length, female gender appropriate, and at least it can be adjusted, you know, then you can get at least a product what has that possibility. To not adjust the saddle is kind of like never ever maintain your vehicle, the car. Okay, the car is not living, but if you don't refuel it, you don't check the oil, the gas, the tires, eventually the motor goes kaput. Mm-hmm. Now it's just a machine. Horses are not machines, and I don't think people purposely misuse or hurt the horse, but absolutely breaks my heart to see how many horses suffer in silence, and people don't want to do that purposely. They didn't know that it's from the saddle. And if I wouldn't have the backup, and I have people around me who studied horses inside out, I would never speak out so loud, because I was thinking, oh, it's just a bad horse. It's not a bad horse. The horse is in pain. So if you want to have a horse pain, Mary Claire, you're absolutely right. There is no short way around it. You have to fit the saddle in order to prevent long-term damage for you and the horse.
Awesome. Thank you, Jochen. Really appreciate your time. And thanks to everybody for joining us for another amazing season. I think this is the last episode of the year. Next week we'll be off for the holidays.
We have to post the winner on our next live.
Yes, we will. We definitely will. And thank you guys for joining us for another great episode. And we'll be back in the new year. So happy holidays.
Happy holidays, everybody. And stay safe.